not broadcasting. Recording is on. Test card is on.
Of GrokTALK, brought to you by New Hampshire's leading conservative blog site, GraniteGrok.com. We are your feared, extremist, right-wing, hard-charging, gun-toting, opinionated, outspoken, rabble-rousing, letter-writing, radio, microphone-stomping conservatives and rational libertarians. So get ready for more news and opinion you could only get from GraniteGrok.com.
GrokTALK.
All right, welcome to GrokTALK. Back after a week off, I am here with Mike Rogers. Happy to be here. Don't forget, if you want to listen to past programs, and I got to squeeze this in because I always forget, Spreaker, iHeart, Stitcher, TuneIn, iTunes, and of course at GraniteGrok.com. You can also follow the audio version on my YouTube page and my Google Plus page, and we'd like you to like us on Facebook at GraniteGrok and follow us on Twitter. But we're not going to screw around. We have guests to talk to, and one of them is this gentleman. Greg Moore, good morning, sir. How are you?
I am fantastic, Steve. Mike, good to hear from you. Don't know how you can take a week off this time of year in the middle of a busy season, but, you know, we're glad you're back hitting the ground running quickly.
Well, I had to go to my son's graduation.
Oh, well, I guess that's a good reason.
They had it on a Saturday. I had to go.
Yeah, my grandson's graduation was the week before, so and it was on a Friday night. And these kind gentlemen were in the studio, even Skip, and so I just phoned it in from Providence.
Okay. Well, you know, even here we can phone it in every once in a while.
Yeah, actually, next week is July 4th, so unless we do some special Johnny-on-the-spot interviews with candidates.
Next week is the 27th.
Next week.
We will be here on the 27th.
Sorry,
2 weeks on the 4th, we will not be here. But then we will be at the CNHT picnic on the 11th, and we'll go back to our regular studio program after that. But we want to talk about the budget.
Right.
Don't we?
We do.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, first of all, I think it's important to point out that the budget that's coming out of the Committee of Conference and is going to the House and the Senate on Wednesday is a good budget. I mean, I think that personally, I like the House budget a little more because it spent less money, but the economy looks like it's getting a little better, so there was some opportunities to raise some of the revenue figures. But one of the important things they did when they got that new revenue in was to provide some tax relief to businesses across New Hampshire. Now, we've been at this for over a year and a half talking about how New Hampshire has some of the highest business tax rates in the country. And when you're third highest in terms of the business tax rate and second highest in terms of per capita, business taxes, that means you're in an uncompetitive situation in which you're basically telling your businesses, go to Massachusetts. It's cheaper to do business in Massachusetts. And when would that ever make sense? When do you say, oh, it's cheaper to do business in Massachusetts than in New Hampshire, but in reality, that's where we're at. And yet, Governor Haston came out and said she's going to veto this budget. She is going to step up and veto this budget because it provides tax relief to our employers. So because we're providing tax relief from some of the most uncompetitively high business taxes in the country, Governor Haston has said, I'm going to step in and I'm going to veto this budget. And I got to tell you what, it's incredibly irresponsible of the governor. But what I'll tell you one thing that seems clear is that I think the entire world had a sort of a sea change when she announced it, because it seems to me that she's no longer interested in the idea of running for U.S. Senate, because this is absolutely the wrong decision if you're planning on running for Senate, because if you look at the past history of governors vetoing budgets, whether it's Governor Benson in 2003, back in 1981 with Governor Gallon, or 1977 with Mel Thompson, there's one thing that was in common in all three of those folks. They all lost their next election. So Governor Haston is certainly not doing a politically smart thing, but it's abundantly clear that she is playing to her left base that is saying, look, we want to make this a big issue about how corporations are awful and evil, and these people who are creating jobs are terrible, and we need to attack them. And that's right the mantra that she's following into, and she's saying, I'm going to veto this budget because it provides tax relief to businesses.
All right, so how much was the total previous budget, and how much is the new budget, and what's the percentage of the increase?
So it's important to look at the budget to budget, from the last budget to this budget. And last budget was a $10.7 billion budget. This budget is an $11.2 billion budget. That's a 5% increase overall. So it's important to keep in mind, of that $550 million in additional spending, $460 million of it comes from the Obamacare Medicaid expansion that was not included in the last budget and is included for the first 18 months in this budget. Now, it's important to remember that this budget did not extend or make permanent the Obamacare Medicaid expansion, and that's an important progress, an important reason why conservatives should be supportive of this budget, which is that, like I said, only about, net of the Obamacare Medicaid expansion, the actual increase in the budget is only about $90 million over 2 years.
Wow. $90 million.
Let me just... Now, granted, I'll take $90 million if someone's giving it away, right? But
what I mean when I say $90 million is just, I just find it interesting that's, it sounds like a lot, but in a, you know, I mean, and it kind of is, but I mean, we're talking about $10, $11 billion. And I think that's why it is a good budget, because it's not that much. I mean, obviously things cost more. If you've gone to the grocery store, you know things cost more. Everything costs more. So there's going to be some growth in the budget, because we know they're not going to do the really, really hard work of going in there and scraping out the crud and getting rid of some of the inefficiency, because that's just not this legislature. But
Well, it's important to realize that net of Medicaid expansion, the House budget was actually a negative budget. Spending actually went down budget to budget if you take out the Medicaid expansion, because that was not included in the last budget and is included in this one. So that's why I like the House budget more. But still, as you pointed out, all things being equal, looking at the entire budget to budget, once you get past that Medicaid expansion, which of course, you know, that's going to be a big fight next year, $90 million in an $11.2 billion budget is not an enormous increase in spending.
No, it's not, but it's just the general lack of restraint that we've come to expect. Some of our state legislatures suggested that maybe some outside influence, maybe a PAC associated with a former Liberal mayor, might be involved in this. Is that the case?
You know, I think that has more to do with Senate Bill 116 mm-hmm. than necessarily this budget, per se. Mm-hmm. I think this more has to do with the overarching strategy of the left for 2016, which is to demonize corporations and demonize corporate America. In other words, to demonize the job creators across America, and to attack them and basically to use every opportunity to make them the boogeyman. Because, frankly, if this election becomes a referendum on Barack Obama, the left is toast. They know that. So they have to find some person to get their folks angry and mad at to energize them to get out. And when this budget included tax relief for our businesses, which frankly are struggling to stay in New Hampshire, then that was the opportunity, I think, for the left to say, that's the thing we have to go after, that's the thing we have to attack. And frankly, at a press conference announcing her veto threat, Governor Hassan mentioned it multiple times, the tax relief that's being offered in this budget.
So there's a Twitter campaign going on with regard to the threat of Governor Hassan called Governor Shutdown. And I was going to write a big piece about that last night, and then I'm thinking to myself, you know what, I don't know what the budget number is, so I got to wait until tomorrow when I talk to Greg.
Well, I'll say, based on some comments by one of our state legislators who occasionally contributes, I put together a little photo montage, which you can now see just below our live stream.
Oh, that.
Yes.
The Miss Piggy.
Yeah. Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
Being tempted by some donuts with dollar sprinkles and a little devil on her shoulder that looks suspiciously like a former mayor.
So here's a question for you. Politically speaking, this is something that just seems to be the way. I know you said that for somebody wanting to run for the Senate who's a governor, threatening to veto the budget is a bad idea. But given the dynamics of the left, do you really think it's going to hurt her?
Not among them, but understand that the reason why, whether it was Governor Hassan or Governor Lynch beforehand, the reason why they've had the ability to be popular is because they would often talk about doing things in a bipartisan fashion. And they talk about Republicans, Democrats, and independents working together and reaching across the aisle. And that's not really because they actually expect Republicans to vote for them. It's to get independents to think that they're these high-minded individuals who are worried about good policy. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, this action right here blows a hole in that rhetoric and basically turns Governor Hassan into basically what amounts to a partisan leader for the Democratic Party. And that actually is more damaging than it looks, beyond just the fact that in Washington they talk about blame on government shutdowns. Who's going to get the blame? In reality, what that means is who gets hurt more, mm-hmm. because everybody gets hurt when government stops working. There are certain things we expect, which is, hey, listen, I'm paying these taxes. I expect somebody is going to be, you know, there to turn on the lights and things like that. And so people, Americans, get frustrated when what they're paying for, they're not getting anything. One would argue whether they're getting anything now, but that's a whole separate conversation.
That's true, yeah.
But I think it's important to understand. That's because these people know their congressmen, they know their senators. Here in New Hampshire, we're only according to a UNH poll, 17% of the people know their state rep, and only 19% of the people know their state senator. When the government stops working, the only person who gets blamed is the governor, because frankly, that's the only person most people know.
That makes sense.
Yeah, that does. And so this governor, of course, is expecting to do what the last governess did, which is to springboard into a Senate seat. You know, it's interesting to me that governors of small states seem to think that the Senate has more prestige than they do. This is obviously completely upside down, because the senators should be the servants of the states, indeed the ambassador of the states, trying to reign in Washington, like our current ones don't.
Well, I will tell you this much. It's important to realize that New Hampshire has, according to some study, the second weakest governor in the country. So, if anybody knows, you basically have two opportunities when you're governor of New Hampshire, and that is setting a governing council agenda and vetoing legislation. That's really all the power you have. Yeah, you get to propose a budget, but as you know, the budget the governor has and proposed looks nothing like the budget that's coming back to her. And so you don't have the ability to hire and fire department heads. You don't have the ability to do a lot of the things other governors get to do, like just signing off on contracts. We severely limit the power of the governor. So I can imagine why being governor of New Hampshire with a great title but not a lot of actual power would create a reason why people would want to think that the U.S. Senate is a prestigious step up.
All right, Greg, we're out of time. But thanks for coming on the show.
And
I'm going to quote you when I write my next article on Watchdog, because this is exactly what I needed. And thank you very much.
Perfect. All right. Thanks, Steve. Thanks, Mike.
All right. You, everybody else stay tuned. We will be, as soon as I find the right buttons, back. Hold on.
Hi, this is Rich Gerard, host of Gerard at Large in the Morning, the Manchester area's only locally owned, locally operated, focused and interested, riveting radio show heard live every Monday through Friday from 6 to 9 on 90.7 FM WLMW, New Hampshire Family Radio, and available 24/7 live or archived at GerardAtLarge.com. Be sure to tune in.
This is a coalition of New Hampshire taxpayers. We're located at 8 North Main in Concord, New Hampshire. This is the repository for all things conservative and municipal. So if you have a problem in your town, your school, your budget committee, the right to know law, and now at the top of our list is voter fraud. You have a tip for us, some information for us, you want to join or help us out, cnht.org.
Welcome back to Grok Talk, brought to you by GraniteGrok.com and the Coalition of New Hampshire Taxpayers. Check us out on Facebook and Twitter, please. That's because I'm tweeting today. I have to go right after I do this. I'm going to put Jorge on the phone, and I'm going to go tweet, "Hey, listen to Jorge Mesa-Tejada on education." Good morning, sir. How are you?
I'm fine, thank you. I want to wish you and Mike happy Father's Day before the time runs out.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Oops, hold on. Did I turn you down, Mike? I did. There
yeah,
you are.
Sorry. Yeah, I got the turn.
I had to turn you down because you were on the phone.
Right. Yeah. And welcome aboard, and thank you, Jorge, and muchas gracias. No se habla español como el gobierno Bush, but hey.
Okay, we'll get you up to speed.
Okay. Because if he becomes president, I might need it.
Right.
So we're talking about
guys.
Education. Let's go.
Oh, I thought that I would give you information on something related to education, but that applies to everything.
Okay, that's good.
And
go
that is the how laws apply to the state of New Hampshire. Most people think that the so-called revised statutes annotated, the RSAs, are the true law of the land. And they are. They are in the fact that the legislature gets together and they discuss it and pass the law. However, that's only half of it. RSAs are called enabling statutes. What does that mean? It means that the legislature says, okay, you can go ahead and do this, and stops short of telling you how to do it. So then the second shoe falls, and that is called administrative rules. Administrative rules are created by the legislature. And what they do is they come. Excuse me. I just lost my place. Hold on. It is another RSA, and what this legislative committee that takes the law and creates the how to implement that law. And that RSA is RSA 541A-A. And that is administered by a joint legislative committee of administrative rules, which is comprised of senators and legislators. And what happens is that once the law is passed, the RSA, the administrative rules committee, which are the unelected administrators, educators, think of all the educrats in the Department of Education, sit down and say, okay, this is how you're going to do it.
Mm-hmm.
I like to compare this to you going to your father and saying, "Dad, can I go to Disneyland?" "Yes, you can. I'll talk to your mother." And then your mother says, "Okay, but you cannot fly. You have to take a bus." "No, you cannot go into the ocean before 9, and you have to be out by 3. All of a sudden, you find out you have all sorts of limitations. And they come and bite you before you even know it. The one that in terms of education, the one that gets you most of the time is ED 306, the minimum standards for public school approval. That's the one that tells you what you have to teach, how many administrators you should have, how many psychologists, the class sizes, et cetera,
mm-hmm.
So the point is that I wanted to make people aware that there are two levels of regulation in New Hampshire. The enabling statutes, RSAs, and the administrative rules. And they can all be found in the government website and their laws and regulations. And if you click on administrative rules, there they all are. And there's a whole set for each department of the state.
That of course, comes back to the way government works, or has become to work over the last century or so, where the legislators don't really make clear and crisp laws, and they don't leave the discretion to the individual person or to the individual school, but instead they feed this enabling legislation to a large bureaucracy, or as you say, a council made up of educrats, who then go and make laws, rules with the force of law, which really should never exist.
Right. The insidious part of that is that the average person, you know, the well-intentioned new school board members, will read the RSAs and say, oh, this is what I can do. And they start going, and the superintendent says, oh, no, you can't. Why not? Because it is CD, so-and-so, ED, so-and-so, and then you cannot do it. And also, the thing that really gets me is RSA 541A was passed by the legislature.
Mm-hmm.
So they created their own bed.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
See? So were they trying to say, okay, we're going to be the good guys and pass the good-sounding law, the RSA, and let someone else take the hit?
Yeah. Ah, and now you get to the heart of the matter of the bureaucratic state, Jorge. That's exactly what they do in Washington, too. They're cowards. They won't pass a law that specifies exactly what restrictions they wish to apply. They create a huge bureaucracy that does all the restrictions for them, and then they say, it's the unaccountable bureaucrats, without mentioning that they created the unaccountable bureaucrats.
Exactly, and that's why when you go to testify before the legislative committee and you say, you know, you should do it this way or the other way, they say, oh, no, that's too restrictive. But guess what? As soon as they pass the statute, the rules will hold you by the neck and say, here, this is the way it's going to be.
Yeah, the only way we're going to get our freedoms back is by a wholesale closure of departments at the federal and state level, and I just don't see that happening. It's going to take a sea change in public opinion. The sea change probably won't occur until after some of the people are drowning.
That is one. And then the other thing, too, in terms of facilitating learning about the law for a new public official. I don't know how often you refer to the RSAs. If you go to any, let's say, section on education, which is the one I consult most of the time, you really have to fish through about maybe about 10 or 15 different statutes before you can find what you need. Try to find out how a teacher is hired. If it's 189, then if it is going to be rehired, it's in another law, and then it's another subsection. You never have it organized. So if you are a brand new school board member and try to do your job, because you swear to uphold the rules and the laws, and try to get yourself informed on the situation, it is almost an untenable situation. It's so bad that what I did, I compiled a set of the must-read regulations and rules and laws that they have to read, because they wouldn't be able to find that on their own. It took me years to find out.
Right. So we have basically Jorge's rules for schools, right?
Hey,
no.
There we go.
No. I just made an index. You know, trying to clarify things because, like I always say, dictators are powerful not because they have armies, but because they control information.
Right. So, yeah, in that case, we'll amend that slightly, kind of like Cliff's notes. It's Jorge's notes for rules for schools.
There you go.
Jorge's notes for rules for schools. We should post that somewhere.
Yeah.
With a link to a website that's got them on, if you've got them. I mean, this is something that aspiring school board members everywhere in New Hampshire ought to have at their fingertips.
Well, I don't have a website, but I would like to give it to you guys, and you can post it.
Oh, we would do that gladly, with credit and everything.
I don't need credit. I just want to make sure that the information gets out to the right people.
Well, you can,
to,
you,
to the voters and everyone.
Well, you can email it to me, and I'll make sure it gets up.
Yeah, you'll get credit.
Well, you will.
Unless you want to hide behind it.
Well, he's on the air talking about it, so it's not like he can hide.
No. You have dared to become associated with GrokTALK.
Worldwide, anyway.
We have listeners in faraway places.
Yeah, my dad occasionally listens.
That's cool.
So that's the message today. I thought I was going to keep it short because of Father's Day. And the thing is, there are two different types. The rules, the laws are the RSA, and the enabling and the administrative rules, which implement the RSA.
Now, we know that there's some school districts that are renowned, not just in the state but the nation. Timberline comes to mind. Wyndham previously, but now they've changed. The voters actually stepped up and said, we're done with you losers. We're going to try something different. Are there any other school districts in the state that you can think of off the top of your head that are in that boat that are just completely abusing their authority? I mean, not school boards specifically, but like superintendents and stuff that are just abusing their authority.
Oh, I have my hands full with our local one, with Timberlane and the RSA 55, which is Timberlane and Hampstead. Mm-hmm. Hampstead is lucky. You know, we belong to 55, but in 1992, we made a pact with Timberland. He said, look, we're the smaller district, and we do not get full superintendent services. So how about if the assistant superintendent becomes our de facto superintendent? And in fact, that's what has happened since then. So we're insulated from the shenanigans at
So you don't have to worry about the Earl of Metzler? That's good.
Yes, we do.
Oh, you do?
Because he's still our de facto superintendent. Mm-hmm. I mean, he is our superintendent by law. Mm-hmm. So he can always pounce anytime he wants.
Just lurking.
But the day-to-day operation is Dr. Wilson, Roxanne Wilson, and she is very professional, even-tempered, very knowledgeable, all business. It's great working with her.
Well, that's good to hear because, you know, her boss is, he isn't regarded very highly by people who really care about the way this business is supposed to conduct itself.
You're right. In fact, we already, 2 weeks ago, the school board had an item on the agenda about separating from the SAU and going to another one or become our own SAU. Mm-hmm. So the current in Hampstead is, you know, to get away from SAU 55, because we're the smaller district, you know, it's sort of a 9-to-5 vote.
And I know Hampstead's a pretty well off town. You guys could probably pull it off. Do you have enough schools?
Oh, we don't care about that. We just have two schools, and our schools.
Oh, that's right. Because you go to Pinkerton, right? Yes. Yeah,
right.
So you wouldn't even need them.
Not really, because what I was thinking about is if we join Chester, which is single mm-hmm. district SAU.
Sure.
Their kids also go to Pinkerton.
Oh, yeah.
And Auburn was thinking of joining Chester because their kids also go to Pinkerton. So look at this. Three homogeneous districts, elementary, local, high school, Pinkerton. Mm-hmm. How nice, huh?
That is nice. So, I mean, is there a movement afoot to do that? How do you leave the SAU that you're in now if that's the way people want to go? They just vote? Or
it's a two-year process.
Okay.
And the first year you put in one article to create a study committee. Then the study committee has about 4 months to come up with any one of three situations. Stay the way you are, become your own SAU, or join another SAU. If it is any one of the last two, then it has to come up with a plan, complete plan, financial, et cetera, as to how to accomplish that.
Mm-hmm.
Then that plan goes to State Board of Education by December. The State Board of Education has through the end of January to vet it, approve it or disapprove it. If it is approved, then it goes on the warrant for March, and if it gets a 60% majority because we're SB2,
mm-hmm.
then it becomes effective the following July.
That's awesome. Well, I hope that works out.
Yeah, but we have to take the next step. We don't know
Correct.
How many. You know, there's been a lot of buzz about that because after, you know, you've been reading what Metzler is doing in Timberlane,
right.
And with Sandown and everything else.
Oh, the whole thing with Sandown is crazy.
It is crazy. So everything like that is being read about here in Hampstead because we share a paper, local weekly, with Sandown and Dandel, and so we have, you know, full coverage. And so the people are saying, what the heck is going on?
Would you say the majority tenor is moving towards separation, or?
is hard to gauge.
Yeah.
Because, you know, they're having people who will say that, but as usual, when you ask them to, do you want to sign on the dotted line as a petitioner, they say, well, I have kids in the school. You know, they don't want to do it. The only way would be to put the article in the warrant and see how much it gets.
Yeah. All right, well, we're just about out of time, Jorge. We got about 20 seconds left. I want to thank you very much for coming on. I look forward to talking to you next month.
Likewise, and thank you, and fascinating as always.
All righty.
You're welcome. Take care.
Our next guest isn't here yet, so we'll just kill Tom till he gets here. Thanks a lot, Jorge. We'll see you. All right. I got to remember how to do this now because I'm doing short breaks at the end. We're supposed to have George Lambert in. Sent him a message. I didn't know if he was coming yet. I haven't checked to see if he answered me yet. And he did. And, yes, he's at the Hooks at Toll, so he will be here shortly, hopefully.
Okay. So
after the break.
Do we need to insert a break anyway?
We do. We're going to do one because it's easier for post-production, and that's how we work around here.
That's just the way he rolls.
All right. So this is Grok Talk. You guys stay tuned. We will be
right back.
Hi, this is Rich Gerard, host of Gerard at Large in the Morning, the Manchester area's only locally owned, locally operated, focused and interested, riveting radio show heard live every Monday through Friday from 6 to 9 on 90.7 FM WLMW, New Hampshire Family Radio, and available 24/7 live or archived at GerardAtLarge.com. Be sure to tune in.
This is a coalition of New Hampshire taxpayers. We're located at 8 North Main in Concord, New Hampshire. This is the repository for all things conservative and municipal. So if you have a problem in your town, your school, your budget committee, the right to know law, and now at the top of our list is voter fraud. You have a tip for us, some information for us, you want to join or help us out, cnht.org.
GrokTALK.
3, 2, 1.
We'd like to welcome you to another edition of GrokTALK, brought to you by New Hampshire's leading conservative blog site, GraniteGrok.com. We are your feared, extremist, right-wing, hard-charging, gun-toting, opinionated, outspoken, rabble-rousing, letter-writing, radio, microphone-stomping, conservatives, and rational libertarians. So get ready for more news and opinion you could only get from GraniteGrok.com.
GrokTALK.
Welcome back to GrokTALK. We turned that down a little bit too soon. Brought to you by the Coalition of New Hampshire Taxpayers, CNHT. Their picnic is coming up on July 11th. That's a Saturday. The annual taxpayer family picnic, which is in Hillsborough again, the town of. And you are welcome to go. You can get tickets online at cnht.org. Please go sign up. It's a presidential primary year. And in a presidential primary year, there are very often presidential primary candidates at the CNHT picnic, and there's guaranteed to be a lot of people there, or at least representatives of. So go to cnht.org, get some tickets, go hang out. You get food, burgers, hot dogs, stuff like that, and it's indoors, air-conditioned, and they have a professional PA system this year.
Oh, that'll be different.
So you'll be able to hear...
Am I on?
The guests. You are.
Okay.
I can hear you just
fine. That'll be different because usually what happens is that the crowd who are getting together for the only time of the year get so carried away with their own conversations and arguments that they forget that there's somebody talking in the corner. So a professional PA system will be a godsend.
Absolutely.
As of course, our shotgun mics, without which we'd never capture the speakers either. It's a great event to go to, and it's at the VFW at the western end of Hillsborough. And if you're coming from the south of the state, there's some nice dirt roads you can use to get up there. Ha ha.
You can take the that turnpike. What is it?
I guess it's either the first or second. Second New Hampshire Turnpike.
Yeah,
or something.
It's just a long straight, long flat straight. Stretch of road.
Yeah, mostly dirt
through the middle of nowhere. Which is not the middle of nowhere because it's right in southern New Hampshire. It's not that far.
Yeah, and it cuts across nicely, diagonally, and comes out.
It feels like
just
it's nice.
Comes out just south of Hillsborough, and you can cut through again to the west end and come up by the VFW.
It's really a nice drive.
Yeah,
it really is.
I love doing that. But Yeah, more to the point, I love going there and covering that event, whether as I've occasionally done at a candidate table or as part of Grok Talk, or once as I was the guy projecting James O'Keefe when he presented remotely. We're usually in the thick of it there, and I'm sure we'll see lots of candidates.
Okay, we're just kibitzing here a bit till we get Mr. Yeah. Lambert in the building. I was going to say, we're going to do the. Can we do the iPad stream thing? Because I'm not going to lug all this equipment there. There is a 603 Alliance table there.
There
so
is going to
be there.
We're
going to
be there. There's going to be a 603 Alliance table. Certainly, if I can get set up close enough, we can live stream it from the iPad. I'd still recommend that you bring the recording camera so we can have high quality video with the audio turned on.
Absolutely. I wholly intend to bring the recording camera to the
Because that way, after the fact, you can have it without all the noise and mush that will unfortunately be the case of live streaming it with a more omnidirectional microphone.
Yeah, I'll have to just set it up close enough. Hopefully they'll be... we've usually been able to do it okay.
Yeah, so if we get there early enough, we can get set up close. I've usually done that.
Yeah, we can get in there early, too, because I think Ed said that they've got the room for the day. They don't have to run at the end.
Yeah,
you know, when it's over, you used to have to pick up real quick because there's another group coming in, and usually it's not available early enough. So we have, I think, pretty much the whole day to get in, get set up, do our thing, and then we can relax and leave at a casual pace.
As always, I'll bring the MiFi, put the antenna up outside the room because that gives me an advantage over all the cell phones inside the room to get a little bit of digital bandwidth. And we'll run our machines off it. You bringing a PC, Steve? Just for the sake.
I will be bringing my laptop.
So you'll be able to tweet out the goings on, and an occasional photograph. We'll have the recording camera, and I'll be making use of the iPad or maybe even the iPhone, depending on whether I need to get up close and handheld to live stream the event.
So there you go, CNHT picnic. But you should go.
You should.
You should go because there's food. And it's a good cause, and this is their major fundraiser. This is how CNHT funds all the work they do.
There's food, there's camaraderie, there's...
And there's lots and lots of activists.
Indeed, and lots of libertarian activists as well. You'll usually find a larger-than-usual Ron/Rand Paul faction there.
And there will be a straw poll.
Yes.
The CNHT straw poll.
So which is another good reason to come with your friends if you've got a candidate you're supporting, because straw polls are bendable. And you want to make sure that if you're supporting a candidate, you bring along a few like-minded friends. I'm not suggesting you buy the votes, but, well, that's sort of the way straw polls work, which, by the way, is why the Iowa straw poll finally got canceled. The only thing it was really buying was a little bit of fame or maybe infamy for the state GOP in Iowa and some funds for them. And it got to the point where the big candidates were saying, you know what, this isn't going to work, going to go our way, so we're not going to come. I am blessed that I managed to get there for what was, in fact, the last Iowa straw poll in 2011. When Herman Cain was on the trail, Michelle Bachmann, Ron Paul himself, Tim Pawlenty, and I forget who the fifth tent was there. There were five or six candidate tents. And, it was one hell of a fair. A lot of people, a lot of talking, a lot of sunburn.
Yeah, because you're outside. There's tents and stuff, but I mean, it's...
You're outside, and brother-in-law Christopher was with me. We were handing out brochures at the gates and meeting and greeting and trying to get people to come vote for our guy. You know how it goes.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Was that Herman Cain?
That was Herman Cain, yeah. I still think the man's a great conservative. I wish I had more time to listen to his radio program.
Okay, I'm trying to get these tweets out.
A man of convictions, which is why they went after him.
Oh, yeah. They found a way to get to him, and they did. So that's kind of what they do.
Exactly. You know, thinking of people of convictions, there's a few of those out there. Which brings me to that other straw poll this week on Monday. Come on in. This week on Monday, the Federation of Republican Women held their annual Lilac Luncheon. And they held a straw poll, and about there were 96 votes cast, and the surprises were who were at the top and maybe or maybe not who were at the bottom. And there were a lot of non-votes, and yes, it's posted up on Granite Grok. I'll say non-votes, there were a lot of candidates that got no votes at all. So at the top, amongst this crowd of mostly more mature ladies with moderate Republican leanings, I'd have said, was actually Ted Cruz. He had fired him up. And right behind him, only one vote different, was Carly Fiorina, who obviously is really striking a chord amongst women, not just because she's a woman like Hillary Clinton, but because she's an accomplished woman, which, by the way, most of the ladies at the Lilac Luncheon also are, and I think that resonates.
Well, Carly's done a really, really good job of being impressive on every issue, in every venue, almost without fail.
Right. Now, what I didn't know, because I watched it in retrospect, because I have a TiVo, was the day before the Lilac Luncheon straw poll, she had been on close-up with Josh McKelvin. Mm-hmm. And he asked her the inevitable question. So where are you on gun controls, Carly? And boy, did she slap him down. She came right back at him, said how strong she was on the Second Amendment, the people that she believed in the right of self-defense, and that if you looked at where the gun laws were the strictest, she didn't actually say liberal cities, but she might as well have. If you look at where the gun laws are the strictest, the murder rates are the highest. And she basically went right back at him and practically left him spluttering. So it was a very good performance. And that surely didn't do her any harm. Then there was the mid-pack. The mid-pack was John Kasich, which was a surprise at 9 votes, just under half of what the others got. And, he got there, I think, because he had a couple of fans in the audience and because one of the well-known crime families in the state appears to be casting their lot in with John Kasich. Mm-hmm. And that's a little bit of a surprise to me, having been told recently that, it's hard to make their mind up with so many people and good people in the race that they know, and, B, they're all conservatives, said the governor, which, of course, they're not.
All right, we're still waiting for George Lambert. Mike Gill, who's our guest after that, is already here.
That's
and,
super.
And we got to figure out what headset you're on, since I don't even have a clue.
Yeah, and then
let's try that.
Right behind Kasich was Scott Walker
talk.
With 7
huh?
votes.
You can talk.
And,
I don't even know if I have
me
yet.
And George Lambert has a big problem.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He was only getting 20% payoff from the victims of FRM. All you have to do is ask every one of them. He was the one that sponsored the bill to get their money back.
Yeah.
And nothing I said, I haven't said to John Lambert himself.
Yeah.
Well, if he winds up late, it might be because he knows I'm here.
Looks like we may have a lively program.
Well,
folks,
we're going to talk to George about Jennifer, and if he gets here, and then we'll go through all the. Actually, we might as well just start with you since he's not here.
Sure,
let's go ahead.
So anyway, you can read the straw poll results on Granite Grok, but it was fascinating. And of course, right at the bottom, and I mean right at the bottom, were Jeb Bush and Chris Christie.
Yeah.
The surprises were that Scott Walker didn't place a little higher. And then right behind him, I think it was Rick Perry and Marco Rubio. And again, considering it was a room full of ladies and that Marco Rubio has those kind of boyish good looks, or so I'm told, I was surprised he didn't place higher.
Mm-hmm. All right, so Mike, good morning.
Good morning.
How are you?
Good.
You've been busy.
And I'm going to stay busy.
You're going to stay busy? Okay, good.
Yeah, George. I just told him about you, George. You know, about the 20% you were getting from the victims of FRM. How you tried to sponsor this bill,
yes,
only to turn around and cut off the investigation of who was involved in this?
I didn't try to cut off the investigation.
Oh, yes, you did.
Well, this is going to be good.
It's going to be better than you think.
Bear with us, folks, and we'll get them both on with headsets so you can hear them both. It sounds like there's been some interesting legislation, and now we have
got to figure out where you are, George.
Some varying opinions.
You?
Yes, true. Okay. All right. Real quick before we get into that, because we can do that in the next segment if everyone wants to hang out. We wanted to talk about Jen.
Yeah,
Horn,
of course.
Real quick. Let's squeeze that in. How you doing?
Hi.
Let me make sure I have you. I got you. All right.
Okay, that worked.
I'm fine now.
All right, thanks. Atlas Society. I'll be there later today.
Oh, okay, great.
Cool.
All right,
We got a full house.
We do. The latest, please.
So we are...
We'll almost be on schedule if this happens.
So we are
getting lists of the state committee members. This is like the most secret documents in the state as far as like who was elected and selected.
Mm-hmm.
Seems like nobody has the list. We're going literally county by county, talking to people, saying, who are your state committee members so that we can go out and recruit people? I've been talking to area chairman, people like that. Still waiting for Hillsborough County list, in case you know anyone who's got one.
I don't. And I live in Hillsborough County.
I know. Like, you can't get it.
Delegate list, right?
Yep. Though I've gotten most of them now,
yeah.
We're still two counties short, and I can't tell you which ones because we just ran up the hill.
Mm-hmm.
I have some good news. State room and meals tax is absolutely going up, in case you didn't see the...
That's good news.
The motorcycles and stuff. It is just crazy.
Oh, the money, the revenue, yeah. Oh yeah, there's a lot of bikes in state. I think it's... Well, this is like the first bike week in who knows how long that it hasn't rained the whole week.
Oh, that's good.
And so people are like, oh, it's not going to rain. I guess I'll go to bike week. That is good. All right, so the delegate hunt continues.
Yes.
Going along well.
I think both words are accurate, Steve. It seems like a delicate hunt because you don't want to spook the quarry as you collect them.
The super secret list.
Yeah.
Well, I've been pretty public about the fact I'm going to get it
because
I have it from previous years.
Yep.
And I know the people who've signed on with us before, so I know where to go and look for most likely people. But we actually have people who are calling me now to get on the list, which is actually pretty good. We're going to get ready to put up a Google document so people can go and opt in.
Mm-hmm.
So it's pretty exciting.
Cool. All right. And to remind people, this is to call the delegates together for a vote to remove Jennifer Horn as chairman.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And are we going to attempt to remove anybody else while we're at this, or are we just going to focus on
That'll be up to the body itself. When, okay. You know, what we'll do is we'll get the content and discussion matter on the table and let the body decide if they're happy with the leadership.
Okay.
The reality is that any of the members of the executive board could have said to the lady who showed up and said, I have some concerns. They could have actually said, I'd like the floor, and delegated it to her rather than having her, because she says only the, you know, members of the e-board are allowed to speak.
Really?
They could have worked. Oh, yeah. Jennifer Horn said you're out of order. Well, if the leadership of your organization doesn't want to listen to you because you're out of order at their meeting, something's wrong. Any one of those people could have actually done the right thing, and they didn't. So let's let the delegate body decide when the members of the state committee can have a voice and won't be out of order.
Now, you think you're going to get enough people there? I mean, once you get enough signatures, which shouldn't be a problem because you only need 50. Right.
After we have all the signatures, what we're going to do is go and poll the body and say, look, do you want this? We're not going to call a meeting if people don't want it. What we're going to do is we're going to say, we have the ability, okay, either the state party can do the right thing, or we get enough consensus so that we can actually guarantee we'll remove Jen.
Right,
and I will know by the time we submit it to the state party that she is going to be removed at that meeting.
And this is the time to do it. This is the year before the election.
Mm-hmm.
This time next year would be a very bad time to change leadership. But I think enough people have enough problems with Jennifer, the style, the turnover, that it would be at least good to air the problems and see whether the delegates are willing to go for this. Mm-hmm. And as you say, it's not just that you need 50 signatures. You need to line up about 250 out of those 400 delegates, or else you are going to fail. You're going to find you get 190 to 210 or something with the evil gnome sitting on the stage grinning from ear to ear.
Well, actually, the other thing that we're going to do in our letter is actually put that all of the election ballots will actually be counted by unrelated third parties that will pay.
Mm-hmm.
Because I have significant concerns that we don't actually know what the results are, and the party has no mechanism for evaluation afterwards.
Mm-hmm. That's true, and there has been some, the last couple of votes that they've had at delegate assemblies have been kind of iffy.
We had an issue in Hillsborough County where they announced at a meeting that someone had been added to the committee, elected, and at the next meeting they said, oh, we never said that. So you have people in the room going, we heard it.
Yeah.
And they said...
And you're not recording those meetings, so...
No.
Let me just make sure I get this right. I had thought that I'd been told by the chair of Hillsborough County that they forbid any kind of media or recording from their meetings.
Correct.
Is that true?
Probably.
Which basically means they're held in camera, or yeah. which means not on camera, and it's super secret.
Yes.
And
they throw anyone out who they want to.
And you, therefore you're delusional if you think you heard something.
Yeah. Actually, they told Matt Phillips while he was there that he won. I was there, we were all excited. And then the next meeting, they're going, oh, no, he didn't win. And so there were people in the room who knew this. So I asked, I challenged Ray Chadwick. I said, what, you know, well, show us the ballots. I want to see them. And he says, no, only I can see them. And I made a motion to actually go out and produce the ballots because I figure the Hillsborough County body can do that. Mm-hmm. And he has got that so under his thumb. Everyone thinks I'm crazy. I mean, I didn't get elected as a delegate in Hillsborough County for the first time in 8 years this time around. But write-ins beat me. My wife, myself, and Matt Phillips all lost and were beaten by write-ins. I find that really, really strange since, you know, we have been doing so much and been so vocal.
Right, which means you've got to do your organizing at the next level below to make sure that you're... you know, that the county delegates are, as it were, you know, all lined up in advance so that mm-hmm. you don't lose. Mm-hmm. I wonder if the Democrat Party, as is internally corrupt as the Republican Party is, or whether it's simply externally corrupt, meaning we know it's a crime family, but maybe they hang together.
Mm-hmm. Well, I don't think that the Republican Party is intentionally corrupt. I think that they are trying to each serve their own little fiefdom. And what we don't have is the coordination to say, what's our way to win together?
Right, which comes down to some of what's going to end up going on this next couple of years. There are organizations out there, such as the 603 Alliance, that are trying to help the Conservative Party mm-hmm. pick a candidate conservative enough to get the grassroots excited. Mm-hmm. Not scary. Just conservative.
I wish we'd done that in the last Senate race.
Right. And if we did that, or if we succeed in that move, then the chances are that the Republican Party will win too. Mm-hmm. But if the Republican Party insists on picking losing candidates, insists on ignoring the grassroots, eventually the grassroots will say it's third party time. Mm-hmm. And everybody says that's the worst way of doing it. Mm-hmm. And I don't just mean the establishment types. You know, even ultra-conservatives like Richard Viguerie say, taking over the party the right way is the way to do it, not trying to create another one, because that will splinter the vote worse. But ultimately, if we don't have the party responsible to its or responsive to its own grassroots, we are going to have an untenable situation, and nobody is going to be enthused to vote for the candidate that comes out at the end of the process.
Well, I think this is going to tie into what we talked to Mike about in the next segment and why you're running for governor.
I am.
And one of the problems isn't just that the party politics, but the way the party politics is tied to state government and the corruption that goes on with the little families that are in charge of everything around here. And we'll dig into that because if we want to have the thing between you guys later, that's fine. But what you have to tell us about, and you've been talking about it, for years now?
Years,
okay. And this really needs to keep coming out. And we really need to talk about the people at the top in the AG's office and state government and the political parties and their connections.
It's a business.
It's a business.
They're all corrupt.
And we want to...
They come out of two law firms.
Yeah.
I mean, the house is on fire. We're talking about arranging the furniture. I mean, I have hard evidence right through, yeah. even with George here.
Yeah.
Unless, George, you want to tell everybody you weren't getting 20% from the victims.
Actually, there was an offer made to me to be the potential lobbyist mm-hmm. for one of the families and potentially others, but I didn't force anyone.
Well, we can talk to all the families.
You can
they
go ahead.
Said 20%, and George
actually,
said, I don't know if I can trust you. I don't have a handshake. I mean, I don't have a contract, maybe a handshake. You know what we can do? We can just line up about 40 of them. I already talked to them all and go through witness groups, right? Mm-hmm. George,
and
don't bullshit. We had this conversation.
Actually.
You know Richard Head's notes?
Mm-hmm.
You know, the one that knew about the Ponzi scheme in 2003? You know who gave them to me? This guy right here, George Lambert. You know, Richard Head's trying to get a summary judgment on me now on a forged tax return, right? How'd you get those notes, George? From the AG's office.
I went and asked him for them.
Oh, you went from asking. It only proved that the Ponzi scheme that they knew about at the AG's office and the Banking Commission in 2003. How's that?
I
and do you know why we have those and why George gave them to me? Because it would have given them evidence to overturn FRM, give them pennies on the dollar with the explanation you are not to carry this forward. Do not investigate. George, we had that conversation. In fact, you told me to shut up and we had 12 votes. Or are you going to call me a liar?
I actually believed we had 12 votes.
Oh, you bet your ass you had 12 votes because it was fixed. That's
why. What was fixed?
The vote was fixed. How did he know the 12 votes already? I am telling you what this is. And that document, by the way, George, you might be laughing. It's with the Justice Department right now. And I put the case number up on the Internet. How many hits we had downloaded the case number to go on to a complaint? 1,000 by 6 o'clock in the morning.
Wow. That's
my goal is 50,000, which also be a formula how to turn around and confront this corruption.
So
you talk about grassroots, right?
Yeah, this is,
you want
this
a grassroots?
This is the root
corruption.
Of the problem. To get to the corruption, we can't use, I don't think we can use, obviously, the state, the government,
not
the court system.
Not one person in this state, which is why it's open for business. Bill Shaheen is part of this with Gene
mm-hmm.
Shaheen.
Yeah.
Who do you think put Hassan in? Hassan told herself she owes a career. Ayotte came from the AG. Who do you think covered it up? Right. They wanted this to go away. I've only had a dozen death threats.
Can you
only see how on the Internet.
How
and
do
text
we get
messages,
around the state court system, though?
Department of Justice.
Okay.
And guess what? I have a case number there. I got 3 state immunities going on right now.
Mm-hmm.
High-level officials. That's right. And if I can get them immunity and get them to turn around and I sign a release, we're going to find out everything.
This is so important because we talk about every court case, every from vote fraud to everything. It's all screwed up.
And right down to the police. Every one of them is leveraged by the other. Why
right.
do you think these guys get in trouble, thinking off of trouble, over and over again? You don't think they may know something? Look at Hildreth. All he said was, if I go down, the governor goes down. He gets a one-bedroom apartment in Kansas City. Now, why do you think he's there? Right. I only found him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's in Kansas City?
That's right. One-bedroom apartment.
We're going to have to dig into that a little bit.
We're not talking about a one-bedroom apartment with bars, are we?
No. But we should be. He only had 2 of his brothers on the Ponzi scheme. You think that? And then turned around and this, think about this. The prosecution of FRM was done by John Kakavas, who only did work for me.
Mm-hmm.
And I went this close and told him I was putting his ass in jail. You can ask them. He prosecuted FRM. You know who was the defense attorney for FRM? Mark Howard, his business partner 3 months before. And for the 8 years before that, if you're going to commit a crime, you better hope your best friend's on the other side. And that's what he had.
Yeah.
That's corruption.
There is, and it's not just this issue, it's everything. This whole state. We've talked to people, national guests who write for, you know, they talk about the way the court system works in the state. They talk about everything from civil asset forfeiture all the way to the state suing gasoline companies, petrol companies for stuff that's in the water that they said to put in the gasoline or whatever, you know. And it's just
you mean when MBTE was
right,
was mandatory
exactly.
until they found
and
out
then
it,
they,
le- it leaches out of
and then they sued
everything.
Them all and, and it's like, you know, you told us to put it in there and now you're suing us for putting it in there. And it just,
I can't tell you how many businesses that I speak to. US Brake Springs were just one. They had a $70 million contract annually with the UN for water. Bill Shaheen wanted the Billy tax. You know how many turn people won't come in, businesses won't come in this state? Do you know we were the worst state in creating jobs in the country?
Yes.
Right.
Yeah.
Because they won't pay the tax, the Billy tax.
I only have
a check for an extortion for $100,000 with his ass on it.
Excellent.
Excuse me.
Billy tax. Oh, that's okay. We're not FCC regulated.
No, good. So it's the Billy tax because are we talking about the business enterprise tax?
Bill Shaheen.
Yeah, I know.
Shaheen and Gordon.
I know.
Gene, you want to do business in state? Listen, I wanted to put up a sign. Only cost me $100,000.
Oh.
Right. And I have the check. And I said, if you cash it, it's criminal.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Now I have it, and so does the Justice Department. And I only have a controller who worked for me for 30 years. Her husband got in trouble for child molestation. Shaheen leveraged him. Right. You can have your 3 daughters be taken away from you, your husband goes to jail, or you can work for us. Now, what I'm saying is in court documents. Right. Bill Shaheen.
Mm-hmm. So we're going to we're almost at the end of this segment, but we're going to go into, I want to ask you, well, I'll ask you in the next segment since I'm all out of time, but I don't think that's federal court case is going to get much traction until we have somebody in the White House who will actually not try to get in the way and defend the Shaheens, right?
Well, we can't do it. I'll tell you why. Ready? Every president president-elect goes into these states, and you know what they seek out? The power brokers. Mm-hmm. You know what the power brokers are? Generally the guy who's the most corrupt. Guess what? I mean, who do you think Hillary Clinton's campaign manager is? The same one Bill Shaheen and Gene had.
All right, we're going to get into this in a minute. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
We'll be right back. Yep.
When asked whether she still supports Obamacare, Senator Jean Shaheen said,
"Yes, I do continue to support the law. We're beginning to see some positive results."
How can Senator Shaheen say we're seeing positive results when 22,000 of our neighbors have already lost their health insurance? What's worse, the Boston Globe reports the state's only health insurance provider radically reduced the number of hospitals in their network, forcing some people to drive over an hour for lab work, even when there's a hospital within a few miles of their home. When pressed about lack of access, Shaheen said,
"There are some hospitals that are not covered, unfortunately, and I certainly hope that's going to change."
Jean Shaheen promised us we could keep our doctors and our healthcare coverage. Now she hopes we can get to a local hospital? Call Senator Shaheen at 603-647-7500. Tell her we need more than hope. We need leadership. Paid for by Citizens for a Strong New Hampshire.
Hi, this is Rich Gerard, host of Gerard at Large in the Morning, the Manchester area's only locally owned, locally operated, focused, and interested riveting radio show, heard live every Monday through Friday from 6 to 9 on 90.7 FM WLMW, New Hampshire Family Radio, and available 24/7 live or archived at gerardatlarge.com. Be sure to tune in.
This is a coalition of New Hampshire taxpayers. We're located at 8 North Main in Concord, New Hampshire. This is the repository for all things conservative and municipal. So if you have a problem in your town, your school, your budget committee, the right to know law, and now the top of our list is voter fraud. You have a tip for us, some information for us, you want to join or help us out, cnht.org.
Hi, this is Rich Gerard, host of Gerard at Large in the Morning. You're listening to Grok Talk.
3, 2, 1.
We'd like to welcome you to another edition of Grok Talk, brought to you by New Hampshire's leading conservative blog site, GraniteGrok.com.
We are your feared
extremist, right-wing,
hard-charging,
gun-toting,
opinionated,
outspoken,
rabble-rousing,
letter-writing,
radio,
microphone-stomping conservatives and rational libertarians. So get ready for more news and opinion you could only get from GraniteGrok.com.
Grok Talk.
All right, we're back. Welcome to Grok Talk, brought to you by the Coalition of New Hampshire Taxpayers and GraniteGrok.com. Make sure you check us out on Spreaker, iHeart, Stitcher, TuneIn, iTunes, YouTube, Google+, GraniteGrok.com, of course, which is where you might be listening to this program right now. Please remember to like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter. All right, well, we didn't anticipate that this was going to happen, but, well, it's here, and we're going to go with it.
It's lively. So FRM has been a controversy for a long time in New Hampshire. It was an evil Ponzi scheme. A lot of people got defrauded out of their life savings. The state has repeatedly failed to prosecute it, and now we have two people that are actually involved in that mess from different angles, both in the studio, and it's going to get lively, folks. So let's go. We have George Lambert and Mike Gill.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Well, I
go ahead with your accusation.
Well, accusation. How about this accusation? For years now, right? I've been putting stuff on my sign, running these videos, right? Who's suing me? Name one person who's suing me. Name one person who says I'm lying. When I said Shaheen ran the Ponzi scheme, Shaheen put Hildreth in. Hildreth had his brothers on it. Gallagher was Hildreth's best friend, who was protecting him. Now, George, I made it very direct. I ran victim group now, didn't I, with these FRM people? And didn't I go there? Have I charged them anything, said I was going to charge them anything?
I have no idea.
Right. How about this? Who's worked closer with them than me?
Probably no one.
Right. So, you know, I have sat down and talked to them. I've seen them cry. I've seen them not have money to buy teeth. I've seen all this. Mm-hmm. They all came to me and said that you were getting 20%. You came to them.
No,
and when I talked to Kevin Avard, who you were working with, had no idea you were getting 20%. Or is that not true?
That was totally true.
Oh, so why wouldn't you tell the state senator who was putting in the bill, who was sitting across next to you on the table, that you were getting paid? You think it might have hurt their chances knowing that you were going to pull 20% out? And think about this. What were you doing getting 20%?
That was
victims?
The number they offered me. That one family, not all the victims, one family said, you know, we would like your help, and if we recover money, we will pay you 20%, and we'll ask other people if they wanted to contribute. Doesn't matter.
Oh, so we're having a fund for you. We're contributing with a nice big fat can around the victims and say, who wants to give George Lambert money? How about this, George? First of all, I don't believe you, and I believe that was the deal, and I think we can prove it.
Go ahead.
How about this? Nobody's proven anything I've done wrong, and I've proven everything I've said, which is why I'm not being sued by all these large law firms, which is why the banking commissioner, which I call as a crook, won't take my license, right? Because Furlow's an insurance defender. Now, why is an insurance defender from the AG's office, who I reported the Ponzi scheme to, and came from McLean? See? So, in other words, that is the case. How about just George? If we go with your side of the story, which is not true, it's completely immoral. How about this? Let's charge victims for recovery. You're running for an office. Listen,
no,
I'm not going to tell you.
No, that discussion happened after I lost my election, and they asked me to continue.
Oh, they asked you. Now, why do you think they came to you? You know what they came to me and said? George Lambert told us not to tell you, in particularly.
No.
And I said, they said, we feel uncomfortable with. Listen, you said no? How many people you want here next week?
All right. I wish I had room.
Yeah, like I said, we're going to have to schedule it a couple of weeks out to give him a fair showing.
Yeah.
But let's give George a chance to talk for a couple of minutes, Mike. I understand you're wound up.
Hey, listen, George can say everyone. Listen, let's have George talk. Let's see how it goes.
All right, well, as long as you give him a little while to talk.
Of course
then,
I will.
Then you can rebut his arguments, because if we just talk over each other, we're not going to get there.
Of course, I understand.
And by the way, I'm going to put on the table, not because I'm saying this to defend George, but we're talking about here recovery actions of money in a difficult situation for which my understanding
is... corrupt situation that was run by the governor and the Bill Shaheen.
Fine. But regardless of how it was done, when you have a legal suit to recover money, typically the attorney is not doing it totally pro bono, and usually there's a contingency fee that says...
Right, but who's the attorney here?
Well, okay, that says if I lose, it's my cost, and if we win, I get a small take. And I'll be perfectly frank with you, most big firms that get into this stuff...
It's illegal.
Are looking for 30%.
It's illegal. He's not an attorney. He's not a lobbyist. So
right,
you can come to his aid all you want.
All right. No. Like I said, I'm just putting that on the table as the fact that recovery actions typically
right.
involve...
Let's take the money from the guys who commit suicide. Oh, wait. We can't get them. Well, there was three the other last year.
All right, go ahead,
George.
Right. So now let's give George the floor for a minute to explain...
Absolutely.
Or to tell us the sequence of events and to explain what he's doing and why it's not illegal.
I worked on getting this bill and support for this bill when I was running for Senate. I was very open and upfront about that. I went and saw the Attorney General, Richard Head, at the Attorney General's office. I collected material. I sent it out to everyone. When I was in the House...
What material?
I got Richard Head's notes. I got all kinds of stuff from the website.
What did it say on his notes?
It said all kinds of things.
Well, did it say about the Ponzi scheme and FRM and how they all knew about it in the Attorney General's office? Let's not call it material. Let's call it what it is. Go ahead.
After I lost my election.
What was in the notes, George?
All right. So let's.
Well, wait a minute.
Hang on. Let's stipulate a couple of things here. So there was a Ponzi scheme running with the knowledge of those in state offices and state law enforcement who should have been shutting it down.
Well, he got the notes from the AG, so they had it in 2003. So, yeah, from the attorney from the banking commission. So when we call it material, I mean, hey, listen, this is a piece of paper. What's on it? So let's find out. George, you did read the notes, right? What did because I still have the notes, and so does the Justice Department. What does the notes say, George?
I told you that the notes, the handwritten notes from... Richard Head were different
with
and
who?
Inconsistent.
Who was he talking to? What were the notes? There was one set of notes with a conversation. Now, who is he having the conversation with?
Actually, there were lots and
you know,
lots
the woman that you were running against. You shouldn't remind...
Oh, yeah. Oh. He had conversations with Donna Susie.
Oh. Back, they were the notes were in the discussion to Donna Susie exclusively, and then it was their conversation about other people, like me. But go ahead. So do we agree on those notes?
Hell yeah.
Oh, so we do agree on those notes.
Yeah, well, hang on. We're not getting a chance to get a coherent...
We said material and skipped through it. How incoherent do you want to be? Would it only turn around the material, spells out the Ponzi scheme that the AG's office and the Banking Commission knew?
I get it, but can you pick it apart after he said a few words instead of...
Well, he said material and went through it.
All right.
Which
all right.
I shared with anybody who wanted it. What I was trying to do is...
Who'd you
the
share
facts.
It with, George, besides myself?
They're
going to be witnesses. Go ahead, George. I want to hear it.
Who?
You gave it to many people.
Yes, and I
who
don't...
Who are they?
I don't know.
You don't know?
I will have
first
to
of all,
my...
many, and we don't know. I mean, Jesus. Go ahead.
Well...
Well, what? Many and not one? I'm the only one?
I'm...
He was only running against that candidate whose notes was hers with Head's. Head's only trying to shut me up with a summary judgment right now. Right.
I get all that, but if we stop George word by word, we're not going to get
well, when you talked about material with information that would quite literally would put these people in jail, I think it's worth more than a material statement. Especially
we just don't
when
have that kind of time, Mike. We have to let him get his words out. You can go ahead and rebut him after.
I'm fine, but you did hear him say many and then
segment.
Come up with zero.
I got that.
I want George to go forward. Keep going, George.
Well, yeah, if you stop interrupting him, we'll get more, and then you can pick it apart later, okay?
Right. Well, we're out of time. Go ahead, George.
For this 15 minutes, maybe.
Yeah,
but there's
see?
More. There's more. You've got more time.
Go ahead, George.
Go, please.
After I lost my Senate race, the people I'd been working with to collect the information, sort of construct the whole story so that we could go out and communicate it to people in very small, understandable sound bites, because it's a very complicated situation, asked me if I would continue. And I said, you know, really, I could potentially do something. And they said, we had a meeting. And, you know, they said that... if I would actually work on contingency for them, that, you know, they would actually pay me. They picked the number. They picked the terms. They said, you know, a lawyer is paid this way. This is not in front of a judge or anyone else. And I didn't force anyone to do it. I didn't force anyone to sign a contract. I was working in good faith for the best interest of all of the victims and said, I'm not forcing anyone to do anything. Now, if that's the... if somebody wants to make a separate accusation, go ahead. Show it, prove it, bring anybody you want, but that's not me. People have known me for years, and I actually was trying to do the right thing.
Right. Well, I can bring all the victims,
go
and
ahead.
They did say that. I will. And you know something? They've came to me about it. How about this, George? You just know you just explained you broke the law.
No, I didn't.
Oh, you're not a lawyer. You're not a lobbyist. You broke the law. You didn't even tell, when you sat in that hearing and you spoke to it, did you tell that panel that you were getting paid? You were the same guy who voted against FRM before. Before, you didn't vote for it. Now you get paid, now you will. Everything I'm saying, I can prove. And how about this, George? Is Richard Head, the assistant attorney general, a criminal? And is he corrupt?
I don't believe that any court of law has actually found him to be a criminal.
That wasn't my question. I didn't ask you. I'm saying your personal information, you only took the guy's notes. Is Richard Head a criminal and corrupt?
I have serious concerns about the fact that there's a difference between his handwritten notes and the report he submitted to the Governor Executive Council. That gives me a great deal of concern, which is why as soon as
the
I
the same
found
guy
out,
he has concerns about being a criminal is the same guy who took, while he's running an election, his notes. Now think about that. And you know what in those notes?
And I gave them to you.
It infers criminality. You're right. Who else did you give them to? Who else did you give them to? Right. You know why they gave them to me? I'll tell you why. So they knew I was going to be present at that meeting because I promised the victims I was. And I turned around and went to these people and told them about these notes. They knew I was going to do it. The only way they could have turned FRM over and give them money was new evidence. How's that for new evidence that they produced? So they wanted to turn around and had George leverage it with these people to turn around, then sign releases that they wouldn't go after Hildreth. They were going to say, oh, it's just Hildreth. They weren't going to go after Shaheen and the real corruption in this state. Right. That's exactly what happened. You can get all excited and all, but
I'm
listen,
not getting excited.
I will prove everything. You want these victims here? I'll have them here. I was at that hearing. You know, when you after you spoke, you walked right the hell out. I've got a tape of the on notice. You can get to see it. It's on the internet. And Katavis only resigned 2 weeks later. You know why? Because I was on his trail and have a witness that I'm going in for immunity with that would put Katavis in jail. And it goes right back to Richard Head, which you know is corrupt.
I only can tell you what I've seen, and I said it gives me serious concern, which is what I told you in
right.
your
when
office.
Did you have concerns? After you took the notes or before the notes?
No,
Richard Head's been in every dirty piece of business in this state. What do you think they sent it? Judge McHugh, Richard Head. That's how it works.
I have had concerns about a bunch of things at the Department of, at the Attorney General's office, mm-hmm. but after actually going and sitting with Richard for a number of hours, you know, I think he means well, but he's got a lawyer.
He's a crook, and you know he's a crook. He is an absolute crook. And listen, the AG's office is the cover team. Every time something goes wrong in the state, you go to the AG. I mean, the only ones that get fired out of the AG are their own people, and then they get hired back. You know why? Because they hold the secret. Why do you think Hildreth is in Kansas City and behind bars? Because he has the secret. He only went in open court. If I go to jail, I'm taking Lynch and Shaheen with me. Right? Anybody figured they'd want to ask the question? Oh, I don't know. Why would you say that? No one did. They tapped him on the ass and said, oh, he plays Dungeons and Dragons 7 hours a week. The whole prosecution was corrupt. Alex Walker was part of it. My personal attorney. That I'm the one who brought the Ponzi scheme to him. And you know who I brought the Ponzi scheme to? Walker. Katavis. And then I went to the AG's office. You know who I talked to? Furlough, who now became the banking commissioner. When does insurance defender become your banking commissioner? Right. Wilbur was the basin commissioner. You can't find him with a search warrant. He left. Didn't say why he was leaving. You know why? Furlough told me he was a Boy Scout. Wilbur looked at it and goes, I'm not dealing with this cover-up. So the insurers cover it up. Now, why do you think the insurers might cover up? Right? You don't think we could have a class action shoot with a corrupt banking commission, do you? There's the answer.
We're going to take 30 seconds, and I want to talk about your...
I would have thought that a class action suit would be exactly what the victims would want, as long as there wasn't too big a cut being taken.
Right, but it's all the attorneys in the state. How are you going to get one? I only get an ad for $10 million.
The bar in the state is...
$10 million for an attorney for 2 years, and I can't get one. Now, what do they know that no one else knows? The PCC, Ronnie Wise, controls that. Here's a 64,000 question. How can all these attorneys be controlled? By their license.
Right. Okay.
We're going to take a short break. I want to talk about your run for governor when we come back. Stay tuned, people. We'll be right back.
Hi, this is Rich Gerard, host of Dreddle. In the Morning, the Manchester area's only locally owned, locally operated, focused, and interested, riveting radio show, heard live every Monday through Friday from 6 to 9 on 90.7 FM WLMW, New Hampshire Family Radio, and available 24/7 live or archived at GerardAtLarge.com. Be sure to tune in.
This is a coalition of New Hampshire taxpayers. We're located at 8 North Main in Concord, New Hampshire. This is the repository for all things conservative and municipal. So if you have a problem in your town, your school, your budget committee, the right to know law, and now the top of our list is voter fraud. You have a tip for us, some information for us, you want to join or help us out, cnht.org.
All right, this is Grok Talk.
Hello, Todd.
Hey. All right.
Yep.
It's whisper. All right. Mike's running for governor. He brought up another case in Pennsylvania that I want to talk about because it's kind of been a corruption-based morning. And
it's going to be a corruption-based campaign.
It is. Good. Okay, so Pennsylvania you were talking about when we were on the break.
I was the world champion in horse racing. Won more race than any man's ever lived. You know, so in other words, I'm not this guy who fell off the pumpkin truck, right? Had the largest brokerage firm in the country, too. In Pennsylvania, 2010, I noticed jockeys pulling horses and so forth. I went to the feds and so forth. This was going on. It turned out to be one of the biggest organized crimes syndicates in the country. They issued 3 weeks ago 50 target letters in Pennsylvania. Mm-hmm. So, and then it went into, I don't know if you noticed, but the mayor of Harrisburg with the 32 deers just got taken off to jail. And now all these judges are coming forward. And what I was trying to tell people is the corruption in multiple states like this. And Pennsylvania was, Penn was paying people off. Mm-hmm. Back while they were being investigated by the FBI, Penn National turned around and got a racing license in Massachusetts. Now, who gets a racing license when they're under indictment? They do. You know why? They bribe. Mm-hmm. They pay people off. And you know something? You see Rockingham here? Who do you think's going there, and who do you think's getting paid? That's right, Bill. I name names. Mm-hmm. No one makes a move like that. But what I did was I uncovered this, which in itself would have seemed impossible when it came in. You can read all the articles. In fact, I was on E60 on ESPN, the most hated man in racing, because I was only telling them they were all cheating.
Right.
So here's the plan, to take something so large that is getting national coverage, and I'm going to drop it right on top of this state. I said, you think that's corrupt? Here you go. Here's state corruption. See
now
how
you
that
said
money?
Jockeys pulling horses. What does that mean?
The jockeys were cheating and fixing races. They were betting money through a wire service to Singapore. You know that guy Zayed and all of a sudden had problems with people in Singapore? They used Penn National wire. It's an illegal betting thing. That's mm-hmm. why they couldn't sue him. Right, they could shoot him, but they just couldn't sue him. And that's what I found. And they used the same wiring system to bribe people. Mm-hmm. And what I'm saying in Pennsylvania is happening right now. This is why I brought this up here. This is why I timed this. I have that breaking national news to show them the state corruption. And that's what happens. Industry, politicians. Pennsylvania was open for business. But I can tell you this. From top to bottom, I will put the corruption in this state that trickles to Mass. I've got 8 federal judges that if I get these immunities, they go to prison. Mm-hmm. 8.
And this is kind of the cornerstone of your run for governor.
It is. Right. I turn around and I will
so
be.
Now, so now let's lay it out.
Well, the first thing is I was a businessman and a father. That's really what I am. I had no intentions to be a politician. I only went to the governor, the AG's office, and figured, it's them. So, and it's not like I haven't cried for help, and it's not like I haven't put it out there. So here's the choice. I turned down $50 million on the internet. So here's the choice. If we turn around and just ignore this and walk away with the money. So I had a choice of a lifetime. The lifetime now was how I live the rest of my life is more important than that money. Mm-hmm. And this will continue to go on until someone says, I won't take the bribe. I won't get paid. I won't gonna turn around and keep going. What we have to do is go to the people. We the people, we're the only ones left. It can't be in this state. What I'm telling you my goal is, the case number that I created in this state, I'm going to have 50,000 people ask for that case number to be looked at. 50,000. So if we have 50,000, they just might have to be forced to look at it. And believe me, if they look at it, I mean just a peek, they all go to jail. Why do you think I'm getting immunities now? It is shocking. Mm-hmm. When Richard Head comes out of the wall, you know, listen, what do you think I'm getting one of the immunities for? Dickhead. Right. And he's trying to summary judge because they know I'm close. Desperate people make desperate moves. What we have to do is have people understand how close we are. Mm-hmm. I mean, what do you have? Live free or die. If you don't have injustice in the courts and your politicians, we only asked our children to go to war. To fight for what? Honor and justice? When the people are corrupt there. Shaheen, target IRS and so forth, I'm dealing with all this. What do you think she get in trouble with? For targeting your enemies with the IRS office, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
Given what's the word I'm looking for? Given the altitude of this, I know you said you've had death threats.
Listen, my death threats are on the internet.
Are they? Yeah. Well, that's what we would do. That's what anybody would do if they got them. Because the first thing you do is you make them public and you go, look, this is what I'm.
Well, I went.
With.
First thing I did was go to the FBI, Mass, and New Hampshire.
Yeah.
They only attacked me in Bedford. Almost attacked me. Mm-hmm. You know why? They're not going to touch that evidence. You know why they almost attacked me? Because they wouldn't take the evidence. They asked me to go through a metal detector. I took my phone, threw it across the metal detector, and the guy caught it. I got his fingerprints. Right. That's how bold you have to be. Listen, I said this too. You know how to live in hell?
First of all, you got to recognize that you're there. And then you got to get comfortable.
Yeah.
And I'm comfortable. I have fear.
And that's we see presidential candidates, say we see a lot of high-level people in politics and government. We get to meet senators. We get to talk to, like, over coffee, you know. And so when I got involved in blogging, it became very easy to take that lofty position that they like to have, you know, judges and governors and things like that, and completely throw it away because it's all manufactured because they're just regular people. And you go and you talk to them, and they're like, hey, how you doing? You know, I mean, I know hundreds of House reps. So what? In some states, you say that, and they're like, really? Like you talk to your senators and stuff. And so people have this perception that there's this power that these people have. And it's kind of false. The regular It's called fear. Right?
There is power.
It's regular. There is, and that's what I'm getting to. Because, you know, on TV, you see senators who are pulling strings to get people executed. You see all this crazy stuff, and not everything on TV is real, but that power is real, and those people are intimidated by anybody who poses a threat to that power. And so you're doing that. And
these text messages that threaten my children's life, tell me where they are, how they're going to kill them.
Yeah.
Also said that he works for these people, that the state of New Hampshire is corrupt. His name is Ted Little. I even know who it is. He was one of my attorneys who were working for them. You see in the text messages, he's flying his kids to California before he comes forwards.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So in other words, there's enough evidence. Listen, anytime you have the option between saying it's crazy or let's explain it and explain it away. Anybody explaining anything away? No. I've only put it everything on my signs. Mm-hmm. On this, I am telling you it is true. And I think if we can gather people here and have courage, the most insidious thing that this has been done, and I'll bet you when you speak to people, they'll turn around and say, we know it's corrupt, but what can we do?
We
are trained and conditioned to accept corruption from the same people who's going to put you in jail. Well, you know what? I don't accept that. They haven't converted me to think it was okay. And if we get enough people behind us, and that's the basis of running for governor, is to turn around and unite these people. You say grassroots. Grassroots and commonality is that people know it's corrupt, and they know the truth. They know I'm saying the truth. I see it in the comments. You know who I have issues with on the blogs, and I put them out for you. So if you guys look at it, they're cops. All cops.
Yeah. The cops are the ones saying we know it's corrupt?
No, the cops are saying, oh, it's crap.
Oh, okay.
He's paranoid.
Okay. All right.
You've been... I only got somebody at the assistant AG's office. I tracked that down. He was saying, oh, this is all paranoid. Turns out he's working for the AG's office.
Yeah, well, that's... And you have the evidence. We're running out of the end of the segment, and that's important. And the blog site?
Stateofcorruption.org.
Stateofcorruption.org.
Listen, okay. I put the evidence out there. You can see it. You can see Richard Head's notes. Bang. You can read them yourself. So if anybody questions what they say, you get to read them.
Are there any national legal groups at all interested in this? I know, like...
I have two presidential candidates interested in this.
Oh, good.
Right. One I've been working with for 6 months. Uh-huh. You know, they want to see where this falls.
Oh,
and
yeah.
If it looks like they come in for a hero, then they're ready to scoop in.
Well, of course.
I haven't taken their money, and I haven't taken any of the help yet. But I can show you a phone where they keep calling me.
That's important, and that's another thing about the election year and running for governor. There's a lot of focus on the state. There's a lot of media in the state, so the timing's really good. You have the evidence. If you have the people, I mean, this is the time to do it, and so that's a really great way to do it.
Which is why I'm right here.
Right,
there's
exactly.
The strategy. And is that going down in Pennsylvania for the little extra understanding what I'm doing? It's all coming to the same place.
We got about a minute. Now, I seem to remember reading initially when you first started becoming public about all this stuff, about something with racing, but it was down in Kentucky or something. I don't remember if I read it wrong.
Pennsylvania.
It was all Pennsylvania.
It was all Pennsylvania.
Okay.
It was only the Genovese family. Now, what I'm saying is I caught wires coming up here, right? Posted them. Do you remember about a year ago, the front page of the Boston Globe, three people from the New England Costa Nostra. Not my words, them.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know I had all three in the wire transfers from Penn National up here? They own nudie bars.
Yeah.
Also bookies.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
Yeah. All right. Well, thank you, sir.
Things that are over the border in Massachusetts because we don't allow them here.
Oh. Listen, Massachusetts doesn't have anything on the corruption of New Hampshire, but they are blood brothers. and you can't work with one without working with the other. I found that out.
Well, I'm sure there's something going on when certain types of businesses are on one side of the border and certain types are on the other because of the way the taxes and laws work out.
Well, it depends how much you have to pay. Bill Shaheen's a little greedy.
Well, I definitely want to talk about him. We're out of time. We're going to have our next guest, James Simpson, author of Red Green Axis. We videotaped him a couple days ago talking about his book. We're going to have him on to talk about refugee resettlement. Gentlemen, Mike, George.
Thank you.
Mike, hi. Thank you very much for coming in. You talk too much. All right. Stay tuned. We will be right back. We got to make a phone call.
Senator Jean Shaheen said, if you like your current health plan, you can keep it. That's not true, Senator. 22,000 New Hampshire citizens have been kicked off their insurance plans. Hospitals in Rochester, Concord, and Portsmouth, they aren't allowed to provide care under the exchange. Senator, you were wrong in your comments. You should apologize for your misleading remarks. I'm calling Senator Shaheen at 750-3004 and telling her I want my doctor back. You should too.
Paid for by SaberPAC.org, not authorized by any candidate or candidate committee.
We are struggling. Rising health care costs are part of the problem. Senator Jean Shaheen helped create this mess we're in. As a state senator, her bill chased 21 insurers out of our state. It reduced our choices, raised prices for New Hampshire families, and when Jean Shaheen supported Obamacare, it limited access to 10 of our 26 hospitals, reducing our choices again. Tell Jean Shaheen she's made healthcare worse. Few things are as important as finding the right doctor. And under Obamacare, that's harder than ever. Over a third of our hospitals no longer available. Our doctors no longer covered. Fewer choices, longer drives. No state has been harder hit than us. And even after watching it impact New Hampshire, Congresswoman Ann Custer still supports it. Call Ann Custer. Tell her Obamacare isn't working for New Hampshire.
This is a coalition of New Hampshire taxpayers. We're located at 8 North Main in Concord, New Hampshire. This is the repository for all things conservative and municipal. So if you have a problem in your town, your school, your budget committee, the right to know law, and now at the top of our list is voter fraud. You have a tip for us, some information for us, you want to join or help us out, cnht.org.
Three, two, one.
We'd like to welcome you to another edition of Grok Talk, brought to you by New Hampshire's leading conservative blog site, GraniteGrok.com. We are your feared extremist, right-wing, hard-charging, gun-toting, opinionated, outspoken, rabble-rousing, letter-writing, radio microphone-stomping conservatives and rational libertarians. So get ready for more news and opinion you could only get from GraniteGrok.com.
Grok Talk.
All right, welcome back to Grok Talk, and I am Steve McDonald here with Mike Rogers. We have other people who are hanging out in the studio to give a listen, but the reason we're here for this segment is to talk to Mr. James Simpson, who's recently written a book called Red Green Axis. I had a chance to meet him a couple days ago and find out about this book, but it's about refugee resettlement and the effort to erase America. Jim, good morning.
Morning.
How you doing?
Oh, very well, thanks.
Are you in Maine by
glad
chance?
Glad to be here.
Yes, I am. Okay, I knew you said you were heading up to Lewiston and to talk about what we talked about. I don't want to get into that too much detail. You've penned a nice little short book on a topic that most people are really unaware of, Red-Green Axis, and I haven't finished reading it yet, but you know, I told you when we were at our little meeting when you were talking about it, and I posted the video of your PowerPoint about the book online, that this is one of the scariest under-the-radar things that I think I've encountered in my however many years of blogging that I've been involved. So why don't you give us a little preface of the idea of what the problem is?
All right. Well, the red-green axis refers, of course, to the hard left and green. People think of environmentalism, but we're talking about the green of the Muslim flag. So we're talking about the axis between the American left and their Muslim allies around the world. And as if you've been paying attention, it's an odd, strange thing that the left has found common cause with Islamic radicals who, you know, murdered, who consider being gay a murdering offense, who suppress women, and they on the surface, they appear to be dead set against every single thing that the left claims to believe in, and yet the left and the Islamic radicals work together. And recently, the Southern Poverty Law Center, for example, Mark Potok of the Southern Poverty Law Center, identified 12 prominent women who have the temerity to be opposed to Sharia law in the United States. And it seems almost incomprehensible that a hard-left organization like the Southern Poverty Law Center would be defending the Sharia law, which makes women second class and demands all kinds of outrageous civil rights violations just as a part of their operating law. So what's going on there?
Well, let's give people some background. This started as a UN program many years ago, and basically what we're talking about here is immigration policy and refugee resettlement policy being used to bring in, and most recently, as James was referring to, Syrians, Iraqis, people from Muslim countries that claim to hate us or have factions that hate us, and resettling them in cities and towns all over the country. Now, if you read the book, there are a couple things that are startling. First of all, the numbers. But I think what people probably really want to know about is the amount of money that's being used by the government and the groups that are unaccountable. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Sure, absolutely. Well, the people think of the refugee program and the asylum program as specifically for people who are basically fleeing for their lives from war or oppression in other countries. And in some cases, that's true. But the immigration, the refugee agenda in the United States, or basically for the Western world, was planned back in the 1970s by the United Nations at the UN Conference of Human Settlements in Vancouver, Canada. And that laid the groundwork for what we're seeing today. And their universal goals included things like abolishing private property, and this is an important one, seeking equitable distribution of not merely income, but land, resources, and populations. In other words, the UN thinks of socialism and redistribution as not merely applying to everybody having equal levels of income, but it applies to redistributing populations around the world, populations that have unfairly been found in, you know, inhospitable places to live like Somalia or Iraq, and resettling them back in the nice green pastures of the United States. And so this agenda has been going on for a while, but it's only it's reached a fever pitch in the past few years. We have a cap of 70,000 refugees a year right now. We also bring in, however, about 25,000 asylum seekers. And we have a new program that allows the families of these asylum seekers to come along. It's called Follow to Join. That's another 13,000. We have a special program for Iraqis and Afghanistanis, and that's called special immigrant visa, and in 2014, that's 10,000 people. We have something called the diversity visa, where people from all over the world throw in their names in a lottery, and we get 50,000 people a year from third world countries, Africa and Asia, all over the place. And then another one that nobody knows about called the Cuban-Haitian Entrant Program, which brings in another 20,000 people a year. So we're looking really at about 175,000 people a year from countries that in many cases are not at all friendly to us. We are currently importing about 140,000 people from Muslim countries every year, and we are importing about 160,000 people through various programs, not merely the refugee program, from communist countries every year. Most people don't know that. We allow in 1 million legal permanent residents every year. Our entire immigration system is out of control, not merely the illegal immigration. Everything is out of control. And it's following this agenda.
Yeah, I mean, we need the right kind of immigrants. We need people that are willing to come here, work hard, pay taxes, and assimilate and become Americans. And,
sure,
you know, I challenge anybody to be more pro-America and its constitution than I am, with the possible exception of the fact that I'm going to be celebrating Magna Carta this week, because that's what it's all based on. However, we're bringing in people that don't assimilate, and that's a problem.
Well, that's it. And Jim has some stories about these, and it's one of the reasons he's up here, to meet with people, with landlords who have had to take in people from foreign countries who have no idea what plumbing is, who start cook fires in the middle of their living rooms. In one story you said somebody had converted their cupboards into chicken coops. I mean, not only do they not understand our culture, but nobody's helping them understand their culture, despite the fact that these aid groups that are bringing these people in, and I want you to talk about this next, please, Jim, are getting millions, even billions of dollars a year to bring these people here.
Well, I was said landlord, I'd throw their ass on the street, call the police and charge them, and then let the government come after me and say, you can't do that. And I say, what the hell, I can't do that. You would charge me if I allowed anybody else to carry out these practices in my buildings.
Well, you'll be surprised. Maybe we'll get to that. But let's talk about the groups and the money that are – and they're unaccountable, right?
They are very unaccountable. There are nine voluntary agencies, they're called. VOLAGs, in short, and they have virtually a free hand in deciding who gets resettled and where it goes. The UN High Commissioner for Refugees vets applicants and sends referrals to the State Department, and the UN those UN referrals are priority run. We can also open the doors to refugees who are fleeing wars, like some people in Iraq, and or for family reunification considerations. But the UN referrals are priority one. U.S. VOLAGs meet weekly to decide where in the U.S. the refugees will be placed. And this is based on a federal law. They have authority through this federal law to do this, and there's nothing state and local agencies or governments can do about it.
Well, actually they can. They can exert their constitutional right and say, we control this stuff, you shall not. We will not accept.
Well, you're absolutely right. And in circumstances where they do that, where there, for example, is a public meeting and the citizens come out and voice their outrage and say, "This, we're not going to stand for this," the VOLAGs and their refugees shrink back into the dark and they go to a less unfriendly neighborhood to try again. But the law, at least, allows them to do that, and most municipalities throw their hands up and say they can't do anything about it. You're right that they could, but most don't.
And then that's why they're so secretive about the placement process?
Well, it's I suppose that's why. They're secret about it, so we don't really know why they're secret about it. But, yeah, they are extremely secretive about it. They make it very difficult to find out how many people are coming, where they're being placed, and they want to avoid any kind of confrontation at all costs.
Yeah, you know, as I say, basically cowardice. If the state and municipal organizations actually grew a spine, you know, the municipal organizations would rightfully appeal to the state and the state legislature and say, this is unconstitutional. They cannot impose this on us. Will you stop it?
Well, true, except that in a lot of cases, the state governments perfectly happy with it, especially those governments run, by Democrats. They won't do a thing to stop it. And unfortunately, all too few Republicans try.
Yeah, it's sad. As I say, we've allowed the country to degenerate pretty far when the federal government thinks it can kick everybody around. So let me ask you, you said that they are deciding where these people are placed. Are they deciding based on, a climate similar to what they have back home, ready access to jobs, something to get them integrated, or are they picking somewhere where they can buy a few votes?
Well, you know, I have been looking at the that suggestion that they're placing people where they can, boost their voting rolls, and that may well be true. What I've found in most cases, though, is where they're putting people is where there's plenty of access and plenty of existing infrastructure for social services. You know, Maine has very generous welfare provisions, or did. Governor LePage is trying to reel that in a little bit, and he deserves a lot of credit for that. And he's getting endless amounts of trouble for it from the Democrats. But they look for those cities where there's a strong welfare infrastructure, and in a lot of cases where there's already a pre-existing population of the, you know, type of refugees they're trying to resettle.
Perfect. So, in other words, if we want to drive Bill de Blasio into total bankruptcy, we just take advantage of his better nature and resettle them all there.
All right, Jim, we're going to take
a
quick 60-second break. Stay on the line. We will be right back after I do this. Okay.
Hi, this is Rich Gerard, host of Gerard at Large in the Morning, the Manchester area's only locally owned, locally operated, focused, and interested, riveting radio show, heard live every Monday through Friday from 6 to 9 on 90.7 FM WLMW, New Hampshire Family Radio, and available 24/7 live or archived at GerardAtLarge.com. Be sure to tune in.
This is a coalition of New Hampshire taxpayers. We're located at 8 North Main in Concord, New Hampshire. This is the repository for all things conservative and municipal. So if you have a problem in your town, your school, your budget committee, the right to know law, and now the top of our list is voter fraud. You have a tip for us, some information for us, you want to join or help us out, cnht.org.
All right.
We're back.
We have James Simpson on the phone, author of Red Green Axis. And I want to talk about money, because that's one of my favorite subjects, because I don't have as much as some people. But
whatever you do.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
Whatever you do,
mm-hmm.
don't take it on a percentage.
No, don't.
To be paid on the back end. Like, it's just crazy talk.
All right, that's a different story.
No.
Anyway.
And more to the point, money is what drives all of this stuff. And all of these groups.
And it's god-awful amount of money.
Yeah, all of these groups that are basically socializing our country are set up supposedly as do-gooder organizations.
Catholic charities, blah, blah, blah.
Well,
Jim will give us the list.
Yeah, which are then fed government money from socialist legislators to continue the process of effectively subverting us from within.
So how much money do these groups get?
De Tocqueville would be horrified, not to mention the founders.
Well, in 2014, they received $1.3 billion.
Can I get my 20%?
Yeah, right. And that includes, there are two large organizations that resettled the so-called unaccompanied alien children that flooded the border last year.
Complete with their families.
Yes, right. But most people don't realize that they weren't exactly unaccompanied, because there were 65,000 approximately unaccompanied children, and then there were another 65,000 families that just so happened to coincidentally be along with them. And so we're talking about 130,000 people, and that's not the sum total of the immigrants that we let in. That's only Central Americans, non-Mexican Central Americans on the southwest border. You know, there's more came in through Canada, and more came in from Mexico. So that's not the entire story. That's just the big story. But including two of the biggest agencies that resettled the unaccompanied alien children, the VALAGs made $1.3 billion last year. And we have Church World Service, which got $46 billion, something called the Ethiopian Community Development Council in Arlington, Virginia. They got $15 million. The Hebrew Immigrant Aid Society got $18 million. The International Rescue Committee, they got almost $100 million. The Lutheran Immigrant and Refugee Service, which I call LIARS,
that's their acronym.
$56 million. Yeah, that's their acronym, LIARS. And up here you might have heard of them as Lutheran Social Services, but it's all the Lutheran Immigration and Refugee Service. The Catholic Charities and the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops made over $560 million. The U.S. Committee for Refugees
and we wonder, and we wonder why the state thinks it can tell the churches what to do when the churches have got their hand out.
Yeah, right.
Shut them down.
Right.
Burn them down. Let's have some real Catholic churches, which are off by and for their parishes.
Yes,
local
right,
control.
Exactly.
Yeah, right.
Most of these organizations, these ostensibly religious organizations, there's also the Episcopal Migration Ministries. All of these organizations, they talk a good line like they're doing the Lord's work as charities, but they are big business. That's what they are. That's all they are. They make lots of money. They're top managers make big salaries, and it's all absolutely, as you said, about the money.
You know, it sounds a lot like, say, a large trades union, the Clinton Global Graft Initiative, Acorn.
I want to know where Barry Lynn is.
Barry Lynn?
Separation of church and state.
All right.
He comes up here and insists all the way to the Supreme Court that we can't use scholarships that aren't tax money so kids can go to religious schools if their parents choose them. But yet we have $1.2 billion, most of it government money, going to religious organizations to move refugees.
Right. And you know, when you talk about the population this guy just mentioned, that's more than the city of Manchester, New Hampshire's largest city.
Right, and that's every year.
Just to put
Yeah, every year. It's the entire city of Derby, where I came from.
Uh-huh.
And these groups aren't regulated. They aren't. They don't answer to anybody, right?
They're churches. They're not
very little bit. They answer some to the federal government, the State Department, the Department of Justice, but they pretty much operate with a free hand. There's something called Wilson Fish States, which based on the name of the two legislators that passed the law. There's 12 Wilson fish states, and in 10 of those states, the VOLAGs run the entire program with no oversight whatsoever. And they can just do whatever they want. But essentially, in all the states where they operate, once they got their marching orders, they do whatever they want, and nobody can tell them a thing.
Are people surprised when you show up and talk about this?
Their surprise is an understatement. They're shocked. You know,
we know some of this is going on. We see the headlines. We see the government tried to resettle, you know, a couple of thousand people here or a couple of thousand people there.
Right.
We don't see the big picture. What you have done is assemble the big picture. And, yes, that is shocking. And it is the destruction, the intentional, willful destruction of the culture.
That is exactly what it is. And that is why the left and the Muslims have found common cause. The immigration and refugee resettlement agenda, this is what it does. It dilutes our American culture. It sucks up welfare resources. And it creates chaos. It creates division, racial and ethnic tension, fiscal stress, and, among Americans anyway, unemployment. And all of this leads to a chaotic, very, very stressful citizenship. But these new Americans, as Obama calls them, are being cultivated as loyal left-wing voters. And the mayor of Lynn, Massachusetts, when I visited Massachusetts, told me that, you know, they had just had their celebration of new citizens in the town, and she went to the celebration, and these people, you know, they raised their hand and took the pledge and got their citizenship papers, and it was a grand celebration. And immediately there was a local Democratic activist organization there with voter registration papers signing them up and urging them to be new Democrats. And so this is a very organized operation, and it is absolutely designed to deliver the permanent progressive majority that the Democrats have always sought. And once they've got that, that's the end of this country. Because
Democrats are no longer
Democrats. They are hard leftist. I call them communists.
You know, it's actually much, much worse than that, Jim, for a couple of reasons. I mean, aside from the fact these laws are totally tilted, I mean, I can't get my white conservative brother-in-law into the country under any circumstances because he's not the right class of person. But what's much, much worse about this is they're bringing in all of these people that have ruined their own countries. You know, we couldn't help the Ethiopians save Ethiopia, so we've brought them here to help them ruin America. That's absolutely great. And I'm sure the people that have got the get up and go to actually get up and come here are the better Ethiopians, the ones that will probably work hard, the guys that drive taxis and do anything to keep their families. But nonetheless, you know, they're bringing all these people in, they're signing up as Democrat voters, and they're diluting what's left of the culture. And that's really the key to what they're doing.
Well, the name of the book is The Red-Green Alliance, Refugees, Immigration, and the Agenda to Erase America. We had about 3 or 4 minutes left real quick. I wanted to find out, one of the statistics that you gave us was with regard to the percentage of these refugees who are still on welfare.
Yeah. they get when they come here, they're entitled to all of the welfare benefits that Americans are entitled to and or the Americans receive. I don't know if anybody's really entitled to them, but
freedom from want, freedom from need, the Four Freedoms Park, where Hillary redeclared.
Right. Anyway, they get all that and more. And the Office of Refugee Resettlement actually publishes an annual report, and in it included statistics on how many refugees were still on various public assistance after being here between 1 and 5 years. So they took, they went as far back as the people who had been here 5 years and all the way forward to the people who had been here 1 year. And they found that in this group, and that's, by the way, 752,000 people, they found that in that group, 56% were still on Medicaid, or they have their own program, Refugee Medical Assistance. 47% were on cash assistance, 74% were on food stamps, and 23% were on public housing. And this cost and approximately, and this is a lowball figure, but it's approximately $6 billion a year. That doesn't include the cost for the unaccompanied alien children, which the Republicans gave Obama in last year's omnibus spending bill, $3.7 billion more. So we're looking at $10 billion.
Yeah, not chump change, except for the chumps that are paying it. So yeah. So I just wanted to make the other point. The deal here is truly with the devil, in as much as the bed that the left has made with the refugees, especially with the Islamic refugees, is going to come back to bite them and us, because in the end, it will create the critical mass that will get us towards Sharia law and the total dissolution of America as founded.
Right.
And,
right.
Then let's see who's first up against the wall when the revolution comes.
You know what I find really funny and ironic about that? I am hearing right-wing conservative presidential candidates saying, I want to bring my religion to the White House. What they ought to be talking about is protecting our government from any infiltration of any particular sect or whatever, in such a way that if they were to ever get a majority, we don't see the destruction of our churches.
Well, Jim, we're out of time. We got to go. Yeah. I want to thank you for being on the program, sir. You have a great weekend.
And the red green access, we'll promote it.
Yes, we will. Have a good day.
Thanks.
Rich Gerard, host of Dread at Large in the Morning, the Manchester area's only locally owned, locally operated, focused, and interested, riveting radio show, heard live every Monday through Friday from 6 to 9 on 90.7 FM WLMW, New Hampshire Family Radio, and available 24/7 live or archived at gerardatlarge.com. Be sure to tune in.
This is a coalition of New Hampshire taxpayers. We're located at 8 North Main in Concord, New Hampshire. This is the repository for all things conservative and municipal. So if you have a problem in your town, your school, your budget committee, the right to know law, and now at the top of our list is voter fraud. You have a tip for us, some information for us, you want to join or help us out, cnht.org.